Very good afternoon from New Delhi, India. On behalf of the COPASA Symposium Secretariat and the COPASA Communication Hub, we render you all a very welcome in the sixth curtain raiser of the COPASA Global Symposium 2019 series. These webinar series, as we have outlined earlier also, are a run-up to the COPASA Global Symposium 2019, which is being held in New Delhi from October 15 to 18 on Citizenship, Governance and Accountability in Health. And as mentioned through our earlier webinar series, we have had so far have had five webinar series. The symposium will see critical deliberations on issues related to accountability in health through the five major thematic axes of community action: indigenous and vulnerable people, sexual and reproductive health rights, private health sector, and the healthcare workers. So this symposium is bringing together diverse 400 voices of practitioners, human rights activists, researchers, donors, policymakers from across 35 countries of the globe. In addition to the five thematic axes, the symposium will be also an opportunity to dialogue and engage in inter-thematic discourses and engage in the practitioners' assembly and learn through creative engagements in open exhibition spaces also. So as a run-up to the symposium in the sixth webinar of the series today, we are introducing the Practitioner Social Accountability Charter along with the Practitioners Assembly. So the introduction to the charter and the Practitioners Assembly will be laid out by two leads for this curtain raiser today. Dr. Abhay Shukla, who is joining us from Pune, is from Sathi, India, and he's also on board with the steering group of COPASA. And the other anchor who is joining us from Nigeria is Dr. Aminu Magashe Garba, who is a coordinator of the Africa Health Budget Network and is also coordinating the Western African region for COPASA. So now I would like to invite Dr. Abhay Shukla to kindly lay out the outline for the charter as well as the practitioners assembly.
So welcome to this curtain raiser regarding the Social Accountability Charter and the Practitioners Assembly. And I suppose some of the participants would be actually coming for the assembly during 15th to 18th of October. And as you probably know from the program, that on the last day of the symposium, we will be having a Practitioners Assembly where we will be discussing and adopting a charter on social accountability. So today we'll very briefly discuss about what we would like to do in the assembly and how we are thinking about this charter on social accountability, and comments or suggestions from any of you are also welcome, which will help us in developing this charter in a participatory manner, because obviously this needs to be done through broad-based inputs and participation. So Aminu will be adding to this. Aminu, you please add about the charter. What I will do is that I'll just briefly mention some of the ideas which are there about what needs to be included in this charter, what should be the broad outline of this charter. So as we understand that today, social accountability in the health sector, as well as in other social sectors across the world, is it's a very important space. And at the same time, it is also, in many countries, it is facing various kinds of threats and various kinds of challenges. And that is why it is important that we who will be assembling during the symposium from across, I suppose, at least a few dozen countries, we all share our joint commitments and our joint ideas about social accountability and health, and also beyond health, so that we have a kind of a document which helps us, provides a vision to all of us about how we want to take forward social accountability in our respective regions and countries. And so therefore, we'll probably start the charter by giving the context of today, both the challenge and the promise of social accountability, in health and also beyond health, how on one hand, This is absolutely critical to develop social accountability, to ensure that people receive quality health services, accessible health services, respectful and appropriate health services in villages, in urban settlements across the world for all kinds of, you know, people from all kinds of backgrounds, especially those who are from marginalized communities. So we will be, you know, stating the, emphasizing the importance of social accountability and also the context today that in many countries across the world, democratic spaces are shrinking, they are under threat, they are being challenged by certain forms of government and certain kinds of political situations where we need to double our efforts to not only defend but to actually expand social accountability in the health sector. So that would be, I think we'll start with some of the context and the need for this kind of a charter. Then we would probably outline in brief what are the kinds of very, very, very diverse efforts and initiatives have been made and are being made to ensure social accountability. And what are some of these broad sort of streams? There may be community monitoring, there may be social audit, there may be various kinds of community-based report cards, there may be different kinds of public events like public hearings, and there may be various other forms also, participatory councils, committees, village health committees, facility level committees, etc. So there are very, very wide range of initiatives and experiments which have been tried out in different countries. So we would note that each of these is important in their own respective context, and we all need to at least know about these different diverse strategies, which form our existing, I would say, our heritage and our you know, the platform from which we are today talking about the, you know, taking forward social accountability in health. So we appreciate and note these wide diversity of social initiatives for you know, social accountability, especially in the health sector. And then also we would look at social accountability processes beyond the health sector, which are maybe in very, very diverse areas, ranging from land rights to employment, right to employment, to right to food, education, in the education sector, various other kinds of you know, social accountability processes relating to very wide diversity of entitlements where people have been developing these kind of initiatives, and the need to learn lessons. Those of us who are working in the health sector, we need to learn lessons from these other initiatives and build alliances with various you know, other such social efforts which are maybe beyond the health sector. And especially those which have arisen from the women's movement, from various kinds of other marginalized sections and groups in society. There may be, you know, people living with HIV/AIDS. There may be people who suffer from various kinds of marginalization and discrimination based on race or caste or other such, you know, social, you know, structures, and we need to keep these into account when we develop the social accountability frameworks. And then finally, we will have a sort of a call for action, and I think Amino will add to this, detailing out what we are thinking about when we outline our call to action. But basically we need to, you know, declare that we would like to powerfully expand, deepen and develop social accountability processes in health as part of the largest struggle to enhance democracy. So social accountability is a very much a part of the wider framework of democracy. And while on one hand, shrinking of democratic spaces can constrict social accountability, but the converse is also true, that expanding social accountability frameworks, empowering people to demand social accountability in the health sector, can also be a very important component of the wider struggle to, you know, deepen and expand democracy. So we need to, you know, look at the wide range of, you know, strategies that we would adopt in our coming efforts, which will include learning, exchange, mutual support, building or strengthening coalitions with various kinds of movements, and also, of course, having dialogue with the whole range of stakeholders, including not only those who are based in the community, but those who are also in various kind of situations of power. So ranging from community-based organizations and groups of various marginalized sections of people, civil society organizations, to academics, governments, national governments, international official bodies, and various kinds of international agencies and donor agencies, and the private sector in health. We need to have a dialogue with all these different stakeholders to ensure that the spaces for social accountability are expanded, that people gain their rightful place in health systems, that people come to the center of health systems, and especially the most marginalized and oppressed sections of people, and that, you know, health systems everywhere are made accountable to ordinary people in a way that delivers to them their entitlements and services which they deserve. So I think this is the kind of broad, very broad framework that we are thinking about. But Amino, you please add to this, especially about the call to action and what more, you know, you also suggest we need to, how we need to look at this social accountability charter. Yeah, I am over.
Okay. Thank you, Abe. And greetings to everybody from Abuja, Nigeria. I'm seeing a lot of Africans, very encouraging in the webinar. Anu from Nigeria, Joyce from Liberia, and many people, Salisu, Awal, Zainab. So this is encouraging. And we hope the social accountability charter will drive the accountability process for the COPASA and the practitioners assembly. I'm sure you are all aware that this week has been very engaging in New York. There are so many declarations have been made this week, which will definitely also influence our action as we move forward. The high-level political forum in New York, the 194-member nation, has launched a political declaration for the universal health coverage. And also on the 24th of this month, the Global Action Plan for Sustainable Development Goals has also been launched in New York by the 12 international health partners in collaboration with many countries. So I want to believe that the accountability charter has come at the right time because of all these global promises, pledges, and declarations. The charter, this is the right time for us to launch our own social charter to hold all those people to account for all the promises they have made in New York. If the civil society are not engaging, most of these documents, they will stay in New York. Everybody will take the flight and say bye-bye to New York and leave those documents and declaration there. So we need to use some of this accountability charter and the assembly as a tool to ensure accountability and holding our leaders to account. So briefly, as Abe mentioned on the outline, I'll just say a bit about the call to action. So the charter, apart from the preamble, the processes, the experience, and the learning, is going to have a call to action. And this call to action is going to have different areas so that it will be very clear and simple of what is expected of different categories of the population. There will be a call to action for the practitioners. What are we going to be doing to ensure that social accountability for health is enshrined, is enforced, is engaged? So what are those messages that will be our own call to action, what we'll be doing in our countries at regional level, at global level for social accountability. Apart from the our own expectation as practitioners, what we'll be doing, there will be a section of the call to action. What are we expecting our government to be doing regarding social accountability? the space I've been mentioned, the democratic space is shrinking. Many countries are bringing more regulation to checkmate or hold NGOs and CSO to account. Some of those issues are politically motivated and they have no basis in terms of ensuring social accountability. So what are we the call to action for the government? What are we expecting them to do in ensuring that the social accountability is enforced and also enshrined? They will also have a section about the call to action to the donors, international development partners, and the private foundation, who are always around in all the countries to support government. So they also need to expect to do certain things to ensure social accountability. So we'll have in the call to action messages for the donors, international partners, and the private foundation. We'll also have a call to action for the intergovernmental bodies. We are all aware they play a critical role. For example, the regional intergovernmental bodies, ECOWAS in Africa, the Asia, Latin America, Europe, they are all different intergovernmental bodies, and they also are expected to have certain things that they'll be doing to ensure the social accountability. And also the United Nations, which is the convener of all the 194 countries for this political declaration for the global action plan, there will be a call to action for the for us, for them also, what would they be doing. So in the call to action, there will be the different section. And also we should not forget the role of the private sector, the corporate bodies. They also are playing a role, different role in all over developing countries, the pharmaceuticals, the companies everywhere. They should. They are also expected to ensure that they are doing their own business within the preamble and within the social accountability process in those countries. So these are some of the area for the call to action. But today is to hear also your idea, your thoughts. And at a later time, Abby and I, we are going to develop the outline and share by email. And also, finally, we'll also develop the charter and circulate. And we are hoping that on the 18th of October, during the COPASA Global Symposium in New Delhi at the Habitat Center, we will be launching officially the social charter for practitioners and also circulate widely all over the world using the social media and email. So this is a brief about the call to action. Abe, over to you. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks Amino for this detailed description, especially of the call to action. And yeah, I think that you have, in a way summarized what we are planning to do, why we, and with my background about why we need a social accountability charter, it has now been fleshed out a little bit more. And now it may be good to get into a discussion and some suggestions, which will, from the participants. So what we will do is that, as Aminu has said, we will circulate a draft and which will be widely circulated, and participants today can also look at that draft and give their suggestions. Today also you can speak about any specific points you feel need to be addressed in the charter, and then hopefully sometime during the symposium also we'll see if we can get some time to have a small discussion to integrate all the inputs which have been received, and then based on all the inputs we would be presenting the charter on 18th of October. So I suggest that now we move to the suggestions and the discussion based on whatever Aminu and myself have very broadly outlined. So I'll just repeat what are we, planning to, what are the key components of the charter? The first component is giving the context. Very briefly talking about what is the context for social accountability in the health sector today across the world, and the challenges in terms of, you know, constriction of democratic spaces, accountability deficits, the role of governments in who may not be fully accountable in many countries. So that is the context. Secondly, noting and appreciating the current existing initiatives and wide range of experiments and wide range of strategies that are being used for social accountability in the health sector. Thirdly, noting the wider social accountability processes in other sectors beyond health and how we need to learn lessons from these and build alliances with these, including social movements and various kinds of rights-based activities. And then fourthly, delineating our broad future strategies and declaring how we feel we would like to expand and develop the whole area of social accountability in health through collaboration, through mutual learning, through support to each other, and also through dialogue and advocacy with the whole range of stakeholders who are, have some influence or some, stake in this field, especially governments and also academics and international agencies and donors and so on. And then finally, the call to action, which will, reach out to and communicate to each of the key stakeholders and tell them what we expect for the developing this area. So I think with this brief and very broad introduction about the charter, I think we can open it up for discussion. Unless Aminu, you want to add something to the background, otherwise we'll go ahead with the discussion.
Okay, so just 1 minute before we open the floor is to say that, as I mentioned, during the COPASA symposium, officially on the 18th, is the practitioners assembly where we are presenting and endorsing the charter formally. But a day before, that's on the 17th of October, there's going to be regional meetings, also called the regional assembly. Africa will hold their own meeting, I think, in Asia, then Latin America. So there are also going to be an opportunity in that meeting for inputs of the charter from the regional meetings, which will be incorporated in the evening before the 18th October, where the charter will be officially launched and presented. And also in that practitioner assembly is going to be about 2 hour session. Before presentation of the charter, there's going to be a panel discussion where we are inviting different experts and practitioners to also share some of the ideas regarding why we are there, the broad picture of the assembly, and also how we intend to move forward beyond the COPASA symposium to use the social charter to hold everybody to account, the practitioners, the government, the intergovernmental regional bodies, the United Nations, the foundation and donors, and also the private sector. So we hope to come back to you again to get input. And please, the door is open now for you to start asking questions, making input, contribution, and we'll take all this forward as we share the outline at a later time. Thank you.
So do we have any comments and questions or some inputs coming in for what the broad outline both Abhay and Aminu have laid out? So kindly pitch in your comments. There's a chat box also. You can put in your comments and inputs through that also. And you can unmute yourself and speak. And please go ahead if you have any questions, comments, or inputs. Dr. Abhay, you like to come in?
Yeah, I am here. But basically, the whole idea of the charter is participation. Mm. So we have 17 participants on this call, of which besides, I think, 3-4 who are the organizers, if they can, if they have any suggestions or questions or inputs of any kind, that will be most welcome, because that will help us to develop the charter. And especially from their own country contexts, if they have any experiences regarding how social accountability work currently, either they are facing any challenge in their work which they feel should be, you know, reflected in the charter, or they feel that there are some, you know, strategies or you know, larger policy issues which need to be addressed to strengthen social accountability on behalf of governments or other actors, then those can definitely be mentioned.
Hello.
Yeah, please come in. Please introduce Hello. Yourself.
Okay. My name is Salis Musa from CHR Nigeria. Yeah, I would like to comment on the accountability charter, which I think is a good thing that comes at the right time, as the civil society organization actually needs something that they will hold on in when they are engaging stakeholders. So the charter is going to be a long way in supporting the work of the civil society organization. But my concern is how the social accountability charter, how is there the COPASA is going to actually work with the civil society at the country level for them to understand the accountability charter, to know what role they can play in terms of using the charter to engage with the government, to hold the government to account on what they sign off to on that charter. So that's my concern. Actually, the civil society organization needs a kind of support or capacity building to work with the charter in terms of engaging with the government. So that's my comment. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm seeing a hand. Anu is raising hand. Please go ahead. You need to unmute yourself. Anu, please go ahead.
Hello, everyone.
Yeah, go ahead. Thank you.
Okay. So thank you so much, Aminu, Dr. Aminu, for the well-presented and outline of the charter. And like Sally also said, it's this is coming in at the very right time, especially for those of us in Nigeria. Consider that just like 2 or 3 days ago, the government parliamentarians actually have opened up another process to gag the civil society engagement. And we all know where it's coming all around. It's actually ensure that civil society voices and citizens' voices are no longer heard. My own question really would be how do we ensure that, as much as we want to ensure social accountability, how do we ensure that barrier between the CSOs and the citizens are actually broken down in a way that we civil society do not continue to take that front stage when you are talking about this social accountability? You know, we need to talk more about. Citizen engagement in social accountability. So how do we actually break that barrier? What mechanisms are in place to ensure that there's sustainability for the use of the charter? Are we going to be creating new structures, or are we going to be leveraging on existing platforms to ensure that the charter has a wide range of buyers and use? So I think That would be my own contribution for now. And we also add up that it would be very nice for us to have a form of code, kind of to say, okay, if this action, this is the action you need to take. If this does not happen, this is what you need to take. Because when you have a charter too, and there's no form of regulation to see if it's working or not, then I think it might not be able to measure the impact of such a charter. So thank you so much, everyone, for organizing this. Yeah.
Dr. Abhay, you like to come in, and Aminu also.
Yeah, Aminu, would you like to respond to both these comments?
Okay, please also jump in as we are trying to find answers to these questions. Thank you, Silisu. Thank you, Anu. And I also saw another question, which is also relevant to the same issue from the chat, from Saleh Raibu Abdullahi, also from Nigeria. So I think this is encouraging from Africa that we are speaking up on this social accountability charter. So I think after the official launching on the 18th, one of the also conversation in trying to respond to your question is we'll be developing like a framework of the accountability charter framework of implementation. It's going to be very simple, not complex. That is beyond the charter. How do we move forward to implement? Because what we discover in many charter or declaration, they will be done, but there's no framework. So at the end of the day, they remain document in a shell and nobody knows what is going on. So we hope to develop implementation framework. What will COPASA steering committee be doing after the October to support implementation and awareness creation? And what will the regional members of the COPASA also be doing in Africa, in Asia, Latin America, in Europe, and everywhere? And also at the country level, as Anu said, we should not create a new platform. COPASA can work with existing platform who are interested to carry this charter forward and also to use it. For example, in Liberia, they have the Liberia Health Civil Society Network. We can work with them to push the agenda. In Nigeria, we have the Health Sector Reform Coalition. We can work with them to move the charter forward. In so many countries, you have in Kenya, we have the HENET, the Health NGOs Network. So I think to me, that would be the spirit on engaging structure, using existing platform to push the agenda. But we have to also show interest. We have to show commitment and resilience. And as you have mentioned, there's a shrinking space of NGOs. The charter has come at the right time to say no to shrinking space and to say no to any dictatorial regulation of civil society and the populist voice in the country. So these are some of the thinking after the 18, developing a simple framework of implementation, and definitely we'll share it widely for everybody to make contribution. So please, Abe, you can jump in, and Sureka to also comment on this thing. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks to all these comments, and I see there are a couple of further comments from Richa and Meena also, which are also important. So firstly, Aminu, thanks for that comment. And I'd like to add to that we should be a little realistic about what this kind of a charter can attempt and what it is not meant to attempt. Basically, I'm drawing upon, for example, the People's Health Charter, which was adopted by the People's Health Movement in its founding assembly, People's Health Assembly, in the year 2000. So what can a civil society charter achieve? It is not like a official charter. It's not like the Almata Declaration, which was adopted by 134, governments. So that has a different significance. But a people-based charter, or a charter which is based on civil society organizations, can do a few things which are important. Number one, it can outline our shared concerns and our shared, I would say, resistance to various ways in which democratic spaces and social accountability spaces are being constricted. And it brings together voices from across the world, and it brings, it also makes us aware that this is not only a problem in India, it's not only a problem in Nigeria, it's probably an issue across many, many countries in the world. So it builds solidarity among us, and it puts on the table, it puts on paper, something which maybe we had suspected or we had just some hunch about, but it actually articulates that in a strong way. So number one, it can bring together these shared concerns and this shared spirit of, you know, solidarity. That is number one. Number two, it can, so one part of the charter can be that we oppose or we resist or we stand in critique of A, B, C, D, E, F, G, you know, shutting down or constricting or in some any way, inhibiting social accountability spaces and processes. Number two, the charter can powerfully stand in favor of and defend different kinds of, practices, and also combined with that demand certain kinds of conducive conditions for social accountability. Because as we have been discussing, social accountability does not unfold in a vacuum. So both society and the state and other stakeholders are supportive of social accountability, are responsive to social accountability, then it will, these processes will expand. So what is it that we very concretely mean by a conducive environment for social accountability? In very concrete terms, does it mean government's commitment to social accountability? Does it mean resources being allocated for social accountability process by both governments and international donors? Does it mean capacity building? Does it mean broad-based awareness generation among the general population about their rights and so on? So what are the conducive conditions and the supportive environment that we are demanding or we are asking for? That also in very broad terms should be put down in the charter. I think that is the second kind of aspect of the charter. And the third is, in a sense, the sort of appeal for solidarity, mutual support, mutual learning, and building and strengthening networks for social accountability, which is our mutual kind of movement building and alliance building sort of process, which we, in a sense, we also briefly kind of flag that, or we encapsulate that also in the charter as a kind of an appeal. So we resist, we demand, and we appeal. These may be three major sections in the charter. This is just a kind of at the level of brainstorming, but I'm just suggesting that. Then secondly, Richa has asked about public-private partnerships in health sector and how can we contribute towards, transparency and social accountability at different levels of healthcare and making healthcare affordable. So I think this is a very important point. Yes, probably even in other countries, as I understand, in many African countries, South Asian countries, perhaps also in Latin American countries, today, public-private partnership, publicly supported health insurance schemes are being promoted on a large scale. And people are told that, okay, you have a health insurance card or you have some kind of a, entitlement. And that should be, now you can go to the private hospital and you'll get some health services there. But when people actually go to seek care in these kind of arrangements, they face a whole range of problems which are closely linked to lack of social accountability or weak social accountability. So yeah, definitely we should include a section in the charter about accountability of public-private arrangements in healthcare, and also about the private healthcare sector as such, which also, as we know, people face a range of challenges regarding their patients' rights, regarding affordability of care, regarding rationality of care, regarding quality of care in private health, in the private healthcare sector. So we I think that's a good suggestion. We should include that in the charter. I mean, addressing these private providers and public-private arrangements. And Meena's question whether the charter will delineate the social accountability strategies specific for each level of government. I personally feel that that perhaps may not be possible in detail. That is something which should go into a manual or into a guideline or into a guidebook or something like that. And it's going to vary a lot across different countries. And we have to be aware and sensitive to that, that we cannot make the charter based on the experience of just one country or a few countries. It has to be inclusive and, you know, has to reflect the common concerns and the common approaches. So maybe we may not be able to go into that kind of detail, but what we can do is to emphasize that this accountability is not just at the local level. It's not just people in a village demanding better services from the village nurse or from the local primary health center, but accountability runs across all levels of the system. Health ministries have to be accountable. Top health officials have to be accountable. Director of health services or, you know, district level health officers have to be accountable. Even international donors and international agencies have to be accountable. So I think that aspect, what I would read from this suggestion given by Meena is that, you know, we need to emphasize that accountability enforcement needs to be across levels of the health system. Which is something that, you know, that would be a relevant point to include. But the details of the actual mechanisms will vary from country to country and, you know, may not be possible to go into that level of detail in a charter. This is just my my initial response, but Aminu and others, you know, you can add to this.
Yeah, thank you, Abe, for this response. Just to say briefly, and also in responding to Richard, is that the charter will be what we outlined, plus the input you are making. But we can, at a later time after the launching, we can now develop like a simple framework of implementation. As Abe said, like a guideline. So we can call it any name. But it just provides simple steps on how the charter will be implemented. It becomes a guide for regional organizations, for country level networks to use, for a subnational groups to also make use of. And one of the issues we could add is that we could say COPASA is not going to create COPASA small one at country level, but to work with existing platforms to push the agenda and implement the charter. So we'll have a simple framework, and we hope that you will be around either face-to-face or online to support this development of the implementation framework. Thank you.
Do we have any more comments, suggestions, and inputs coming in? If anyone is interested in suggesting something, please pitch in.
Can we hear the voices of the youths, the young people in the forum, if there's anyone? We want to ensure that the young people are also carried along. If they have any opinion on how they believe the charter will also address the issues, please, from Liberia, from Nigeria, from India, any young people around, please share your ideas. Thank you.
Yeah, and one other aspect where also you can suggest now or you can suggest later also is how do we actually present the charter? You see, it's going to be a huge collective exercise, and ideas of so many people will flow into the development of the charter. So it will be not at all a good idea for just one or two people to present that in the assembly. we should think of some creative, innovative, exciting way that the charter is actually presented, you know, the different sections and whatever. And also, you know, we'll need to have at least some languages into which it is translated, like, for example, Spanish for the Latin American countries, and maybe French for Western Africa, and so on, at least some Hindi maybe for the Indian participants. So at least, so it will need some work and some creative presentation. So any of you who is has any ideas about that, or who would be like to volunteer in helping in any of these, is also most welcome to do that. So it should be something which is like the charter is about participation. The presentation of the charter should also be, you know, genuinely participatory and exciting and interesting. That is just a suggestion. So if there are no more comments, then I think we can wind up. But please, all of you who have joined today, do remain involved in the process. If you are already, you have, if you have not done that, then you can send your email addresses. So, you know, to the COPASA secretariat. Maybe Surekha, you can just give the secretariat email ID here on the chat box, so people can send in their suggestions by email, and send your email addresses so that we can, you know, keep you involved in the process of developing the charter. And we look forward to your inputs and meeting most of you or many of you in the symposium.
Yeah, I've just shared the email ID through the chat box. So all of you can pitch in your comments, suggestions, or other queries if you have regarding the charter. So, and if you have your comments, kindly put a subject head as COPASA Social Accountability Charter, so we can identify the mails, like these are inputs regarding the charter.
Yeah, and it's great that Richa has already offered to help for in the, she said that we can have a community participation workshop, or just make a collaboration video. And that's a great idea. Richa, where are you based? If you let us know, then, you know, we can definitely involve you. If you're based in Delhi, then definitely, you know, we can think of ways of involving you before the symposium also. And of course, okay, thanks. Good to know that. So you're based in Delhi. So yeah, and any other volunteers from any other country are also most welcome to send in their, you know, email addresses later on. Surekha, please note down Richa's email address and we'll keep her involved.
Yeah, I've taken.
Yeah. Okay, so I think Anu has also responded. Please, Anu, give your email address if you have not sent it already. And yeah, that's great. So can we wind up now? It's almost 4:30 Indian time. I think this is the time that we had planned. So Surekha, anything else you want to add in the end about the symposium?
So just some closing remarks from you, both of you, then we can wind up if there are any closing comments. Aminu, you'd like to say something?
Okay, 30 seconds. Thank you, everybody, for joining this interesting and exciting discussion around social accountability charter. We look forward to more engagement with you, and please make contribution. And beyond the symposium, we'll come back to you to discuss implementation and carrying the social charter forward. We need to share at the country level. We need to share at the regional level. We need to create more vibration and galvanized action around the charter all over the world. So we look forward to that interaction with you, and we are always available to answer to your question. Have a wonderful chatting with you today. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Amino. And I'd like to say that a charter is like a flag. It's a symbol. It inspires people. It gives people a sense of direction and unity. And if you have any kind of, you know, protest or mass action or demonstration, the people are most important, but the flag is also important. So ultimately, the charter will be carried forward by all of us through our joint efforts. But let's also try to, you know, raise this flag together. It'll help us in mobilizing in the period up to the symposium and even after the symposium to carry forward the agenda of social accountability for health. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Abhay and Dr. Amino, for laying out the broad outline of the Social Accountability Charter and introducing the Practitioners Assembly as well as the call to action today. So as mentioned by both of our speakers today, we would like this process to be an inclusive and a participatory one. So please keep sending in your comments and suggestions on the email ID that we have shared just now, copasasymposium2019@gmail.com. So we'll be very happy to all of us for all of you to join on this in this conversation that is going on. So we will wrap up for the day today, and we look forward to welcome you in the COPASA Symposium in Delhi soon. And so we are very excited to see you all and meet all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.